Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, short and succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. At question number one, I call Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, President Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that local authorities have encountered difficulties in engaging with electric vehicle charger contractors to repair EV charging points.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Through the grant funding that the Scottish Government has provided to local authorities to purchase warranty and maintenance agreements, we expect suppliers to honour their contractual obligations so that when a charge point is broken, it is fixed on time. Local authorities who own EV charge points, including those on ChargePlace Scotland, are responsible for procuring chargers, selecting installers and agreeing appropriate maintenance packages with their chosen supplier. And once their initial servicing packages have expired, they may choose to extend agreements with their supplier or seek alternative contractors.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the Minister for that reply. And I was first made aware of one EV charger my constituency needing repairs last summer, but there have been others since. And I know at Inverclyde Council, they informed me that they are unable to get contractors to actually attend to carry out these repairs. So can I ask the Minister to outline what work the Scottish Government is undertaking to improve EV charging infrastructure in Scotland and increase the numbers of contractors able to maintain these EV chargers as more people become reliant upon the service?
Minister.
Yes, indeed. Last year, the Scottish Government published its draft vision for public electric vehicle charging in Scotland as a well-designed, comprehensive network that works for everyone. Our Electric Vehicle Infrastructure Fund aims to enable £60 million of public and private investment to double the size of the public charging network to at least 6,000 charge points by 2026. Transport Scotland has considered the range of skills that are required for the maintenance of these charge points. The lack of formal recognition of qualifications has been identified as a barrier that will be assessed as part of a review falling under the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan update, and access to training across Scotland is critical, and Transport Scotland has been investing in mobile equipment for colleges to support training in more remote areas and support a just transition to net zero.
Liam Kerr.
Very grateful. One thing which won't help in the repair and maintenance of EV charge points was the Scottish Government's decision to no longer subsidise the repair and maintenance of plug-in points, so cash-strapped councils struggle to pay for the upkeep of the chargers. And that's led to huge hikes in the charges in places like Aberdeen, Aberdeenshire and the Highlands. So will the Scottish Government reconsider that decision to ensure lower costs at the charge point for drivers?
Minister.
Well, I've already indicated in my first answer the support that has been provided to local authorities, funding to support maintenance of their existing chargers. But the specific commercial arrangements for maintenance are a matter for negotiation between the local authority or other charge point owners and their maintenance providers. We do expect local authorities to ensure that the obligations they enter into through those agreements with third parties are robust and provide for appropriate performance measures and penalties.
Lee MacArthur.
I wrote to the previous Transport Minister raising concerns about the way in which faults are reported. I think there is evidence from the experience of EV drivers that the reported faults aren't reflected either in terms of the number or the duration of those faults. And I wonder if the Minister would commit to asking Transport Scotland to look again at the way in which it reports faults.
Minister.
Well, I'd be certainly happy to discuss that with the new Transport Minister once they're in post. For chargers on the ChargePlace Scotland network, initially the help desk tries to remedy faults remotely where that's possible. If it can't be fixed remotely, a fault ticket is sent to the charge point owner and their chosen contractor to make them aware of the issue, and engineers should be on site within 48 hours of the receipt of the fault ticket. I recognise that there will be concerns around the country, particularly in remote and rural areas where there may be additional challenges, but we do think that across the country as a whole, the level of reliability of the network is high.
Question number two, Gillian Mackay.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it can provide to the Fourth Bike scheme and its partners in the light of the scheme ceasing to operate.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
I'm sorry to see that Fourth Bike has ceased to operate. We provided £181,000 of pilot funding to Fourth Environment Link when it launched in 2019, but they and other schemes have found themselves in similar positions as a result of issues facing Bewegan. enabling people to access bikes in an affordable and easy way is vital to reducing health and income inequality and making communities safer and more pleasant. So we're working with Cycling UK, to establish a new £1 million fund for non-ownership cycle options. And we expect this to start up to support start-up and existing cycle schemes, and we expect that to launch this summer.
Julian Mackay.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Forthbike has proved very popular locally, particularly in the Falkirk area, with over 65,000 miles this year. As the Minister said, Bewegan, the Canadian bike share company involved, has experienced operating difficulties in Forth Environment Link. Recyclebike and other partners have been trying to find a solution to keep the scheme running. Can I ask the Minister what steps and discussions about financial and practical help in the short term have been undertaken by the Government to ensure that cycling provision in Scotland, in Falkirk, Stirling and Clackmannanshire is not massively reduced?
Minister.
I completely agree with Gillian Mackay, and I want to celebrate the success that Forthbike has been able to achieve. I understand from discussions with stakeholders involved delivering other affected schemes that urgent commercial discussions are ongoing, including with the Canadian company that Gillian Mackay refers to. But in this case, the partners led by Forth Environment Link, who run the Forthbike scheme, have not contacted the Scottish Government or asked us to be involved in their discussion. I do note that Highbike, the scheme, was able to reopen earlier this week, for example, and I hope for a similarly positive outcome for Forthbike and other schemes. But this does demonstrate the complexity and challenges of running public bike hire services, setting them up and running them, and that's why the new fund that I referred to in my first answer, providing support for the sector, is going to be very important and beneficial.
Thank you. We absolutely must have more concise responses, and I call Emma Harper at question number 3.
To ask the Scottish Government through which means rural communities can object to any of its proposed policies that would have a direct impact on their local sources of employment, culture or natural environment.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
The Scottish Government is committed to engaging with rural communities on policy proposals which could directly impact them. Rural voices must be heard and must feel their views count. In addition to our usual consultations, which allow people to have their say, rural communities are also being given a voice to initiate change through Scotland's Rural Parliament, a grassroots democratic assembly. And of course, Scotland is the only part of the UK to enable a rural parliament such as this.
Emma Harper.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. I understand that the Scottish Government is at a very early stage of developing its proposals for HPMEs, and I welcome the commitment from the First Minister that no HPMEs will be imposed on communities which vehemently oppose them. However, I do want to ensure that the voices of Fishers in Dumfries and Galloway are listened to and their concerns are taken into account. So can the Cabinet Secretary therefore indicate how communities can make their voices known and ensure any concerns or objections are made clear as the Scottish Government develops its proposals?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I reassure Emma Harper that we are committed to engaging with fishers and others with our island and coastal communities throughout this process to ensure their voices are heard? It's always been our intention to develop these ambitious proposals in close collaboration with those potentially impacted by them, and that's why we chose to consult at the earliest stage possible. Beyond our initial consultation, we've already been engaging with stakeholders. This engagement will continue with more opportunities for people across Scotland, including Emma Harper's South of Scotland region, to share their views as part of that process, and I'm sure that Mary McCallan, as the lead, is happy to keep the member updated as engagement plans are developed.
Alexander Burnett.
Thank the Presiding Officer. In February, Douglas Ross and myself met with a Cabinet Trust on the Murray-Aberdeenshire border, as I had done previously with Richard Lockhead last year. We heard from a community decimated by the oversaturation of onshore wind farms, a ring of steel as they described it. They now face an additional 54 turbines, making it 146 in total, and one of these sites includes Craig Dorney, one of a few unexcavated and intact Pictish sites, only partially protected as a scheduled monument. So can I ask, is there any protection that this Scottish Government will give to our rural communities, or will they continue these modern-day Highland clearances and destroy our historic and natural environment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, one of the big impacts on our rural communities is the impact of Brexit and some of the immigration policies that have absolutely decimated rural businesses.
Members.
In terms of the issues that the member raises, I will get the minister responsible to send a detailed answer. But one of the things the Tories cannot continue to do is to pretend that they support the green economy and renewable energy in order to meet our climate change objectives, and then oppose every single measure that is brought forward nationally or locally that stands in the face of that. You really need to come clean and be honest about your position.
Question number four, Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taken to prevent recent cuts to bus services in Renfrewshire.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
It is disappointing to see service cuts in Renfrewshire. As Mr Bibby is well aware, since the deregulation of the Thatcher era, Scottish ministers don't have the power to intervene over specific bus services. We do remain committed to supporting the sector with £421 million allocated in 23-24 for bus services and concessionary fares. And we've delivered powers for local authorities to run their own services, sitting alongside existing powers to subsidise services. We're working with COSLA on the Community Bus Fund and encourage operators and local authorities to collaborate for the benefit of passengers.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but I think the answer the Minister was looking for is nothing. Despite McGill's cutting a huge 13% of services in Renfrewshire, the Scottish Government have done nothing, and SPT and councils only have very limited resources to step in. At a busy public meeting in Linwood this week, people from across Renfrewshire told of the huge impact these cuts are having on NHS staff and patients, college students and working parents. People in Renfrewshire think these cuts are unacceptable. Does the Minister agree these cuts are unacceptable? And if so, what is the Government actually going to do to reverse these cuts?
Minister.
Well, I do share the member's concern about the cuts he refers to and others around the country, but he is also as well aware as I am that the deregulated model of bus services provision does not give Scottish ministers the power to intervene in specific services. What we have done, as I've already said, is set out new powers for local authorities to run their own bus services and committed to the Community Bus Fund, which will give them the resources to start using those powers. I hope Mr Bibby will join with us in encouraging local authorities, including those in his own region, to use those powers and to work with us as constructively as possible.
Question number five, Carol Mockin.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what value it places on resourcing community sport as part of efforts to eradicate health inequalities.
Minister Marie Todd.
Physical inactivity is identified by the World Health Organisation as one of the four main modifiable behaviours which increase the risk of non-communicable disease, which is why our aim is that Scotland meets the WHO global target of a 15% relative reduction in physical inactivity amongst adults by 2030. Community sport can play a significant role in the achievement of this aim, and Sport Scotland works in partnership with governing bodies of sport, local authorities, leisure trusts, clubs and community organisations to provide opportunities for all to participate in sport. We also invest through Sport Scotland in key programmes such as community sports hubs that benefit communities across the country.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At last week's Health Committee, there were two particular contributions in community sport which the Government may wish to listen to, and I quote, "Access to community facilities is one of the largest challenges that sport and the voluntary sector as a whole face, and we do not have a national strategic approach to ensuring that there is investment in community sport activity as a key route to health and wellbeing." Does she agree with me, and is it not the case that this government's incessant cuts to our local councils and therefore cuts to our communities show tackling health inequality has never actually been a priority to this government?
Minister.
So, whilst I agree with Carol Mockin that tackling health inequality is absolutely one of the most important things that this government and this parliament can do, I completely and profoundly dispute her narrative around this government's role. I'm sure she'll welcome yesterday record investment for Scottish sport in 23-24 from Sport Scotland, with up to £36.7 million for Scottish governing bodies of sport, local authorities and wider national partners. That's an 8.6% uplift on the previous year. And in terms of the funding for our local authority partners, over the last decade, this government has suffered a decade of it. Well, since 2010, we've suffered since... One moment, please. Since 2010, this government and this country has suffered a period of austerity. There has been...
Thank you, Minister. You must draw your response to a conclusion.
There's been a... I can't respond.
Thank you, Minister. I will move on to the next question, and I call Fiona Hislop.
Is the Minister aware that the community swimming pools in Broxburn and Armidale are facing closure due to West Lothian Council proposing withdrawal of all management fees to the Leisure Trust? There is no council in Scotland who currently make no management fee whatsoever. These are communities with serious health inequalities, and with 6-week waits for NHS referrals to Broxburn swimming pool and the need for low impact exercise pending long waiting list for orthopaedic surgery, is she aware that this decision by West Lothian Council was made before proper engagement with health services and patients? And what can the government do to support my constituents on low incomes who need low impact exercise, who don't own cars, to get to the neighbouring swimming pool, and when bus services have been cut in these two towns?
Minister.
So I'm well aware of the proposed closure of these facilities in West Lothian, and our leisure facilities are absolutely crucial to the health and well-being of our population and play a really important role in rehabilitation, for example. We're fully aware of the impact of energy costs, and there's such a significant issue facing many sports facilities, particularly swimming pools. I'm very happy to examine what support I can provide. Of course, the UK government holds most of the levers for controlling energy bills, and we are working with Westminster. We've repeatedly called on the UK government to use all of the powers at its disposal to tackle the cost of living crisis and to provide appropriate energy bill relief to leisure facilities.
Thank you. Question number 6, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of Pride Month, what it is doing to tackle any discrimination against LGBT plus people.
Minister Emma Roddick.
We all have a responsibility to protect and support LGBTQI people from any form of discrimination. It's a responsibility that I take seriously, and I think all politicians need to show leadership on this issue. We have published our hate crime strategy, our vision for Scotland free from hatred and prejudice, where people are empowered, inclusive and safe. We're developing a non-binary equality action plan to reduce barriers and discrimination currently faced by non-binary people, and we will soon be launching our consultation on a new human rights bill for Scotland, which will give effect to a wide range of human rights and will contain provision to ensure everyone has equal access to those rights.
Karen Adam.
I thank the Minister for her answer. LGBT plus hate crimes are soaring across these islands. Our words, both within and out with Parliament, have consequences. This week, Douglas Ross added to his sorry record on LGBT plus rights by suggesting that drag queen story time is inappropriate for children. Will the Minister join me and LGBT plus members and allies across the chamber in condemning any homophobic and transphobic bigotry, which we know fuels anti-LGBT plus hate crimes?
Minister.
Karen Adam raises an incredibly important point that we must take seriously. As I've said, we all have a collective responsibility to protect people from harm, and the Scottish Government is clear that any hatred or prejudice will not be tolerated. Mr Ross may want to reflect on his recent comments, which follow others that he's made in regards to gypsy travellers as well. And we all know there has been a proud tradition of drag artists in our society for many decades. Indeed, just 2 weeks ago, the media noted the death of Scottish comedian George Logan, who is best known for being one half of the drag act Hinge and Bracket, who performed at the Royal Variety Show and regularly on the BBC in the 70s and 80s. And unless Mr Ross also wants to stop children going to the pantomime, I suggest he apologises for his comments, reflects and attends the reading session in Elgin Library, because he may learn something. In the meantime, they have my support and my
thank you, Minister,
for this undeserved backlash.
I call Ivan McKee.
Thank you, President Officer. I recently met with Matt Dabrowski, the Chief Executive of Out Scotland, the UK's first chamber of commerce for LGBT-owned businesses, which provides business development opportunities for member businesses and supports and promotes supplier and procurement diversity. I wonder if the Minister would be interested in meeting with the group to understand better their work in this area.
Briefly, Minister.
Yes, I'm grateful to the member for raising this, and I commend the aim of Out Scotland to support LGBTQI business owners and professionals. I gather that they provide networking opportunities, training, business support and mentoring, and I would welcome the opportunity to meet with them to find out more about how they're supporting LGBTQI businesses in Scotland.
Thank you. That concludes general questions. Before we move to First Minister's questions, I invite members to join me in welcoming to the gallery the Honourable Nonembego Notemba Boyce, who is the Speaker of the KwaZulu-Natal Legislature. And I would also invite members to join me in welcoming Her Excellency Evita Burmistri, Ambassador of Latvia to the UK.